Hachette Audio presents Wisdom from Women in the Bible. Giants of the Faith Speak into Our Lives. Written by John C. Maxwell. Read by Marc Thompson. Acknowledgements. I'd like to say thank you to Charlie Wetzel, my writer, Audrey Morales, who contributed ideas and gave her perspective as a woman, Stephanie Wetzel, who reviewed and edited the manuscript, and Linda Eggers, my executive assistant. Preface. In 2010, I got the opportunity to speak at Joyce Meyer's Love Life Women's Conference. Joyce and I are good friends, and I have often appeared on her television show. On this day, I chose to talk about how to live a fulfilling life and about the importance of attitude. When I got up to speak, I told the audience that for 10 years I had spoken to men at Promise Keepers events, but that I was glad that God had finally given me a greater audience to speak to. The whole place went nuts, and we had a wonderful time that day. When I finished speaking, I couldn't help thinking about my mother, Laura, whom I'd lost the year before. No person has had a greater impact on my life. Mom taught me true love and modeled God to me every day. It didn't matter if I was dealing with a scraped knee, a bruised ego, or a broken heart. She was always there to give a hug, share a tear, and provide a listening ear. I learned love and respect from her. I cannot put into words what I gained from her wisdom and her unconditional love. Every day I miss her. But I take comfort in knowing that she lived a full life for 88 years and that she is now with the one she loves most, Jesus. My appreciation for Mom got me thinking about all the influential women who have shaped who I am, taught me spiritual lessons, modeled leadership, and made my life meaningful. It all started with Grandma Minton, who interceded for me when I was a very young child. I can tell you, I was a very ornery child, so I really needed people to talk to God on my behalf. I believe she almost single-handedly prayed me into the kingdom. And then there was Miss Tacy, my fourth-grade teacher. I deserved a permanent spot in the cloakroom for the way I acted in class, but instead she gave me a permanent spot in her heart. She used to write me encouraging notes. Even today, she still writes to me. When I publish a new book, she writes me a note to tell me how much she likes it. Recently, she wrote one that said, "I had no idea you would turn out this way." Neither did I. My sister-in-law, Anita, has also been a great influence. She, my brother Larry, my wife Margaret, and I have traveled the world together. Anita has always been sunshine to my soul. Her beautiful spirit shines on every person she meets and lights up every situation she encounters. I spent a lot of time with my younger sister, Trish. She was called Patty back when we were kids. She loved to tag along with my brother Larry and me. Believe it or not, when I needed to buy my first car after I graduated from college, she was the one who lent me the money for the down payment. Trish and her husband, Steve, have two beautiful daughters. When Rachel was young, I called her Angel because of the angelic expression she always had. I called Jennifer Sweet Pea, which she loved. Of course, there is Margaret, the love of my life. I fell in love with her at camp and when I was in junior high school. The moment I first saw her, I knew she was the one for me. Including our dating years, we've been together for over 50 years. Her love for God and family has been a great blessing to us. Her years of faithful ministry have been a blessing to many. Our whole world changed when our daughter, Elizabeth, arrived in our lives. I call her apple of my eye. Daughters always have a special place in a father's heart. Elizabeth has one in mine. And when our son Joel got married, Liz, our daughter-in-law, became a beautiful part of our family. Liz has been a delight, and she's made our son a better person. Elizabeth and Liz have also done the most wonderful thing a human being can do for another person. They've given us grandchildren. Of course, we have a special love for our grandsons, John and James. But Madeline, Hannah, and Ella are the three smartest, most talented, and most beautiful girls on the planet. All five of these children bring light into our lives. Margaret and I just took Maddie and Hannah on a trip to Pennsylvania to celebrate their 13th birthdays. We filled them up with history at Gettysburg and in Philadelphia until they couldn't take any more. We had to take them to Hershey for the rides and the water park so that they could enjoy being kids again. I've also been influenced greatly by the women whose stories are told in the Bible. From the time I was a child, Mom talked to me about these giants of the faith. People such as Ruth and Hannah, Abigail and Mary. The traits they modeled and the leadership they exhibited have provided invaluable lessons to me. And that got me to thinking, what if I could write another giants book focused entirely on the women whose stories have been so valuable to me? I imagined what it would be like to visit heaven for a day, see my mom again, and be introduced to these amazing women of the faith. If you've read Running with the Giants or Learning from the Giants, you have an idea about what's coming. We will imagine what it would be like to spend time with 9 giants of the faith. We'll walk with them, listen as they share wisdom from their lives, and take away lessons that can help us every day. In addition, I've asked 9 important women in my life to share their perspectives in sections called Woman to Woman. You'll hear from my wife, Margaret, my sister, Trish, Trish's adult daughters, Rachel and Jennifer, my brother Larry's wife, Anita, my daughter, Elizabeth, my daughter-in-law, Liz, and my 2 older granddaughters, Maddie and Hannah, who are 13. You don't have to be a woman to benefit from the lessons these women have to teach us. The truths they teach are universal. So come along and join me as we take a journey and gain wisdom while walking with these giants of the faith. Ruth, follow your heart to find your hope. I got up before dawn this morning. That's not uncommon. Decades ago, I made a commitment to get up any time I felt that God was waking me, even if it was in the middle of the night. I know it's God if I wake up with a compelling idea or with an urgent sense that I need to pray about something. When that happens, I usually just slip out of my bedroom quietly to keep from waking Margaret. That's what I did this morning. It's 5 o'clock, and it's still dark outside. I'm now in my study, sitting in my favorite thinking chair. The pull of God was especially strong this morning, and I have a profound sense of anticipation, but I'm not sure what God is up to or what he has in store for me. I ask God to speak to me and to direct me in prayer. I close my eyes, and I wait. A vision. I try not to get distracted by thinking about my heavy travel schedule or the work that sits waiting for me on my desk. I want to quiet my mind and be open to whatever God has to say. For some reason, my mind keeps shifting toward my mother. That's bittersweet. Anytime I think about my mom, I smile, because her love for me was unconditional. But it also makes me sad to think about her, because she died in 2009. I still miss her. Suddenly, my head starts to swim. I want to open my eyes, but I can't. There are flashes of light, like I'm seeing stars. And my ears start ringing. The next minute, I have the feeling of falling you get sometimes when you're nodding off. And my body jerks. Am I falling asleep? I wonder. When I open my eyes, I'm standing in a beautiful meadow filled with pink flowers on a sunny day. I can smell the grass and the pleasantly sweet scent of the flowers. I take a deep breath. The air is fresh and warm and dry. I start to look around to take everything in, and that's when I notice you, standing right beside me. You look as surprised as I feel. It's reassuring to know that I'm not alone in this experience. The moment I'm about to ask you how you got here, I hear a voice calling. John! The sound almost makes my knees buckle, because the voice can belong to only one person, my mom. I turn around, and there she is, standing before me. I start to weep uncontrollably. I grab her in my arms, and then I bury my face in her shoulder, as I did when I was a child. When I pull my face up, she is smiling at me.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.